Welcome to Future Role Model, a podcast that praises being unconventional and redefines what it means to be a role model. And today, oh, by the way, I'm your host, Natasha Pearl Hansen, in case you did not know, and I have Brian Moreno in the house, and we were just talking about sweating and getting your car broken into, all that happened in the last couple hours. Is that...
Was that my introduction?
Intro.
I thought you were still going.
You just come in.
No,
come
no,
in,
rule number like one in podcasting just is don't talk until, over.
Yeah, no, I know. There's been plenty of podcasts I've been on where the person intros me for at least like 20 minutes, and I'm like, what? When am I allowed to say some shit?
Well, yes, I did just get my car broken into. That's not normally an introduction.
No, I know, but I mean, I like coming in on what we were just talking about, which is why we have these fabulous bootcrafts that you picked up for us. Which I didn't know, you like must have been getting some sort of air signal that I love these.
Well, let's start from the top. Let's see, on the way here, my car got broken into right in front of Whole Foods. I was just stopping to get a little food.
Yep.
And
that's what you get for being healthy.
Yeah, you know,
fuck your window.
And the parking lot is really bad, though. So it's like sometimes it's like I would rather have my window broken into than go through that parking lot hassle at that particular Whole Foods. So whatever. I come here, and as I was waiting, the people who were doing the last podcast were drinking, and I'm like,
that sounds good.
Yeah, you seem like you would appreciate a fine kombucha. you know, like, I'm to the point where I'm ready to go to rehab for kombucha addiction, just so you know. Like, yep. I'm deep. I'm deep into the kombucha.
I like to say that I balance myself really well between different fields. I love to drink, but I also love to be active and work out.
Sure, me too.
I love to travel and party. I also love to work my ass off. So mm-hmm. I'm like, I enjoy, I feel like I always, when something is presented to me, I'm like, well, this is the universe saying I deserve this right now. So even though I wasn't planning to drink today, I wasn't also planning to work out today, and I did that too. So now I'm just fully balanced.
You touched on a lot of things there. First, let me say that is... not only are you all those things, you should be very proud of the balance that you have in your life, because it's very difficult for most people and for someone to be, to be grounded and funny and driven and, you know, also personable and, you know, be in touch with themselves. That is, it's rare, it's wonderful, and you should be really proud and an inspiration to a lot of people.
Oh, thank you. I mean, I gravitate towards other people that do the same thing too, which is nice.
Well, and that being said, you, like I say, seem like someone who would appreciate a fine alcoholic kombucha.
Always. I will always fit in whatever I can to like the little slot of time. Like before coming here, it was like 12:30, and my best friend / Muay Thai coach calls me up and she's like, come hit pads with me for a bit. And I was like, cool. And then afterwards she wanted to go hit a pool in our neighborhood, and we went there for like 30 minutes. I was like, I got about 30 minutes. I can go sit by a pool for 30 minutes before I come podcast. I will fit it all in.
And how long have you been doing this podcast? Give me, because
over a year.
And tell me about your book. Tell me more about the book that you've been writing.
Oh, the book that I'm working on?
Yeah.
The book, well, this will eventually be a book as well. Future Role Model will be a book. But my book is called Diary of a Bad Fiancé. And I'm planning to have it be my one-woman show in Edinburgh.
Mm.
Edinburgh. I can never say it properly. Edinburgh. Next year.
Well, I've never been, so anyway, it's good to me.
Yeah.
You know?
I've only been, me and Rachel had one show there on our Europe tour.
Sure, which must have been wonderful. I want to hear about that.
Edinburgh is so cool.
How big of a city is it?
I don't even know how to answer that.
Big?
I feel like it's got to be pretty big.
Okay.
We went and walked down by where the really... just something about being in a city where it just feels really ancient.
Sure.
I mean,
absolutely.
It just feels ancient. Yes. We went and hung out in a cemetery
like
for a couple
hours.
You can
feel it and smell it. And
yeah.
The history.
It's rare that I go to a place and I'm like, I want to hang out in this graveyard. But the graveyard was so cool that you know that there's like probably like hundreds of bodies laying on top of each other under the ground.
Well, yeah, and there's mojo. There's actual mojo there.
Yeah.
Like old mojo that ain't like dusted off.
Yeah.
Like been in a long
pretty
time.
Pretty interesting. But yeah, so have you been overseas? Have you played?
Sure, yeah. I travel as much as possible.
Yeah.
You know, given the balance that I have to have. But I always...
that we all try to have.
Yes, I get the itch. My sister lives in Italy. She's got two wonderful...
Oh, shit.
I have two nieces. Yeah, my sister's kids are my nieces. Not my those are my nieces. Yeah, I always call them my cousins, and people are like, "Those aren't your cousins."
I say the same to my aunties. My aunties, I call them my aunties or my cousins, and yeah. I'm always wrong one way or the other. Yeah, I'm like, so I don't know.
But she lives in the south of Italy, in the heel of the boot, and I try to visit often. But Europe in general, like, I enjoy it during particular months. Not right now. Like, once August gets over, September,
yeah.
I love.
Yeah.
I went to Italy, and I think it was April this year. Yeah, I was there April, mm-hmm. a little before the season. Wonderful. Positano, Capri, all through it. You know, that side, that because... And then I got to do a bunch of Rome stuff that I haven't done. And it's kind of before the season, like a golf cart tour of the city and cool stuff.
Yeah.
And to me, like, I love. Oh, yeah.
I haven't been to Italy. I was in Italy when I was young. I was like 14 when I was in Italy. So that was exactly 20 years ago.
And I'm totally plugging Italy. Like, is this video also? Or yeah. Am I just pointing? Yeah. No, I'm totally plugging Italy. But just to get out and experience other places, like, even if sometimes, like, when you just leave the state.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Just yep. I believe I'm up. A man of the people. Like, I fancy myself as that, you know?
Same.
Yeah. And, like, I like to, like, walk places. Like, I like to just smell, like, the earth sometimes, if that makes any sense.
Yeah. I mean, or even just strike up conversations with randoms.
Just random, yes. Just be let. I, you know, sometimes, like, it can be frustrating for people, but they're like, where do you want to go eat or what do you want to do? I'm like, I don't know. Let's just go see what the universe is.
Yeah.
Takes us, you know?
Yeah, that's what me and Rachel were trying to do in Europe a lot, yeah. because it's like, you can look up the trendiest places to go, and it's never, things are paid for, and you're never going to get the right, you know, feel.
Sure.
Like, you got to go to a local spot and ask locals,
sure.
where should I go? What is the best place I can eat that you guys eat at every day?
I actually find Google Maps really, when you go to Google Maps and you just do a search of the area and you see which place has like 1,000 reviews.
Oh my God.
And it's like, I have a system. And then I go see if the reviews are fake. And then I'm like, oh, this place might be good.
I'm going to show you my Google Maps right now. This is something that my friends laugh about this. But my Google Maps, so I star and heart and mark every place I've ever been, ever loved, and ever wanted to go to. And you can look at my map around
wow.
the entire... So, like, if somebody hits me up and they're like, yo, I know you were just in Banff, because I was in Banff, like, this time last year.
And you mark the places. That's
I mark
so
everything.
Smart.
So I have all these places marked throughout Banff and Calgary that people are like, where should I eat? And I'm like, this has a great view. I put yeah. labels in. I know what has a great burger in Banff, what has the best view, what's mediocre service. I also write that.
And you do eat meat?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay. So I wasn't sure. Because were you ever a vegan?
No.
Because you strike me. Doesn't she have a bit of a vegan vibe to her? If you didn't know her, if you didn't know her, you'd be like, I don't know if she's fucking with me.
Yeah. No, man.
And that's not a diss or anything.
I proudly fuck with meat.
Okay, cool. Yeah. I try to balance with everything. Like,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I mean, I just had a burger before I came here. I grew up on farms, and okay. I know a lot of people are, of course, and obviously this will not be a very long tangent because other big comics, other big celebrities, actors and stuff are all like vegan, don't, you know, animals, yeah. whatever. I'm involved in one of my friend's animal rescues. One of my friends fosters
That's
cats.
Wonderful.
Like,
you must get the feeling that you get.
I love
when
animals.
When a cycle gets complete.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I do too.
But, I don't believe you should mistreat them. I grew up on a farm where we raised elk and we raised burgers. You know, burgers. We raised cows.
Wow.
They became
burgers.
We raised the burger? We raised little baby burgers. They became adult burgers.
Yeah. Your parents were bad farmers.
They were like, you just put the whole burger in the fucking ground and then
it grows.
And then
it just grows into little burgers. That's what the Impossible Burger
is. Where do you think sliders come from, bitch?
Yeah, obviously, those are just not fully hatched.
Oh, my God. We raised cows that would become the meat that we would eat.
Well, and that's delicious.
And we were so good to them.
No, but when it's happy meat, like, I believe in energy and the vibes. And if you're like, when you see those pictures of like chickens and those crazy.
That's bad.
No, I mean, that's beyond bad. Like,
yeah.
that's like the hair raises on my neck.
Well,
and
the thing is, I feel like nowadays people want to stand for something because on the surface it sounds good. I shouldn't say everybody, but like people will say, I'm a vegan, you know, animal rights, but they're not checking where their clothes are made. Are they made by children in another country? Like, do you think that that's okay too? It's like, you have to know where to draw your boundaries. What you can and cannot control is pretty large.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, absolutely.
So but you should advocate for what you can, but also like...
The thing about child labor that's also a misnomer is like if they don't get it done in China, they're going to go to Taiwan. They're going to go... Like you can't really stop that.
I know.
Like those people won't have any other jobs.
Yeah.
Like, they won't have any.
It's a sucky reality, but it's just true. So when it comes to the animal thing, I'm like, I try to figure out, you know, where I can buy from... Where I know that the animals aren't treated bad.
Well, I think, supporting places where you know things are done in humane ways is extremely important. But how do you know who's lying to you and who's telling you the truth?
You never fucking know.
I feel like everyone lies to me all the time.
The
advertising, the everything.
Everything.
This doesn't taste like 7% alcohol. It could be 4.
Right?
Like, this could
It might be. Or it could be 20.
Like, and how do I know?
Like, 7% I can drive after. 20% I can't. And so.
Totally. At least you have all your windows. At least you have all your windows.
I know. Barely.
Smash it just to get the gym bag. And I had 2 wonderful water bottles that I really like in there. One that I got in Seattle, like a shaker bottle, you know, for powders.
Yep.
So that's gone.
And your sweaty gym clothes.
Yeah, real bad today because I did a treadmill class. Like it was going to be those got thrown away. But then I know there had to be one or two other things in there that eventually, my goggles, stuff like that for swimming.
Your goggles?
Yeah. I'm glad I'm mentally going through this. I'm making
a checklist of what to
things
replace.
I have to replace. Yeah,
just you know, when you're a little bit tipsy later, go on Amazon and rebuy it all.
Sure. And not that I would ever promote insurance fraud, but my friends are like, "Oh, say your watch was in there. You know, you have the receipt."
Yeah. May as well make the money.
No one from Geico.
I don't think I have
listens.
Any Geico. If so, it'll be way too late. They won't even know. So, where did you grow up?
South Florida and then here. My parents got divorced.
Oh.
I was pretty young.
Coast.
Yeah. This was a far place. My father got away.
Mm-hmm.
And then I went to high school throughout the Midwest because I played hockey. And you couldn't really get ice time.
Where in the Midwest?
Michigan, Indiana, and college in Indiana.
Okay. I'm from the Midwest. I'm going on tour there starting Wednesday.
Whereabouts?
So I grew up in Wisconsin.
Wisconsin. Wow, you have a very non-regional diction. Good for you.
Well, here's why. I grew up in Wisconsin, and then I went to school in Minneapolis. So that was super northern sounding.
But still, you...
And then I moved to Chicago, where I started comedy.
Okay, so I feel like the three balanced. You have very clear diction, though. You don't...
Thanks.
I don't hear much Wisconsin.
Wisconsin will come out when I'm around, like, when I'm around my family.
Gotcha. Because and that's where your family currently lives?
A lot of them live in, it's like half and half Wisconsin, Chicago.
Gotcha.
But my aunts all still say like, don't you know?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Oh, sure.
And where are you going in the middle? I got this shirt in a Walmart in Ohio.
Of course you did.
Yeah, just
because like,
you know, like
that's exotic clothing in Ohio. They're like, a pineapple? That's like the most exotic fruit you can possibly.
It was either $3.99 or $4.99 too, just so you know. When I saw it, I was like, I have to get that. I have another one with tigers on it. Same thing, but black with tigers and tigers and roses. I was like, oh, for $3 or $4.
Oh my God.
A steal.
Those are that's amazing that those are shirts that you wear in your everyday life.
Well, you know, I wouldn't say everyday life, but I do look for opportunities to wear them so that, you know, like at least there'll be some posterity with this. It'll last forever. Like I'll always have a frame of reference where I was like, oh, look at the time I wore that shirt.
I have an affinity for pineapple clothing. I have one jumpsuit.
Says no one ever.
I have one jumpsuit with pineapples on it and one pair of shorts with pineapples on it. And they're both from Tipsy Elves. You know, the ugly Christmas sweater peeps.
Sure, Shark Tank.
Yes. I'm trying to partner with them on a new, on my Vegas show. But
really?
Yeah, so Tipsy Elves, please come on board.
And what is your Vegas show? Tipsy Elves, come on board.
Come on board. Dude, so I got so, do you play in Vegas a lot?
So I've only done the Laugh Factory ones. I have funny stories I can tell you off the air about Vegas.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we'll save those for afterwards.
It's usually not good. Yeah.
Well,
like something happens. Like there's a fight in the audience.
The Vegas crowds are nasty. I love Vegas. I love having a reason to go.
Sure.
I've been to Vegas on many different sides of the spectrum. I've been broke and in my early 20s. I've been with really wealthy people.
Sure.
I've been with for comedy.
It's an interesting way to put it. Yeah, I guess so.
Like, I've seen a lot of different forms of Vegas. I gotta say, when you learn how to do Vegas correctly, it's so fucking fun.
And but what does that mean? What's the word correctly mean to you?
Just, you know, the right people to go to get hooked up at places.
Fair enough.
I'm not a nightclub person, so I like day parties, pool parties. I know where I like to know where to go to dinner. I like to know the right bars that have a good atmosphere.
Sure.
Bars. Sure. You know, not nightclubs make me want to hurt people. And then
well, most of the time they're just annoying.
It's just
annoying.
It's just people that can't handle their shit falling on you, and I don't need that in my life. Not
well,
anymore.
Well, growing up out here, like, I went to nightclubs when it was really, like, it really meant, like, when you were 16, 17, 18, it didn't matter if you were 21, you just had to know the door, like, it didn't matter.
Yeah.
Like, these were clubs, like, this was back when Justin Timberlake and Britney were just getting together, like,
there was
a club called Joseph's.
When they were rocking the carpet and jeans.
Yeah, like, this was back in the day, and I learned, like, going out, and I spent so much time at these places, and I learned the hard way that all the friendships and the people that you meet there, and there's obvious exceptions, but 95% of the time, those people are not your friend. They don't care. Like, they're just not.
No, they don't care about you.
No, sometimes you will. You got just like everywhere else, you'll weed through and you'll meet some good people, but it's really hard there.
I have a couple really good. So one of my best guy friends that I grew up with, we've been friends for like 25 years. He is a pro poker player in Vegas.
Sure.
So we've always gotten along because he was in this really tough business where you're either flourishing or failing miserably. And I've always been in that as well. And so we always really just got along because we came from the same town and we get each other's financial situation on any given time. So there were times that he had been like, you know, a millionaire and then had nothing. And then I would take him out to stuff and then he's reversed that on me when So I enjoy spending time in Vegas, but I kind of started to despise the way I was getting treated by a lot of the clubs there. So
just not good.
Not good pay, not good accommodations.
Well, that's the thing. They treat you so horribly.
Yeah.
Like,
and they don't cover your costs most of the time to get out there. So it's like you're basically breaking even by the end of the trip. And I was like, I want to change. Anytime somebody upsets me with the way that they're doing something, I just challenge it by figuring out my own way to do it. That's what I've done with all my own comedy tours. And then with Vegas, I reached out to a hotel. And I was like, I gave them a whole proposal. And I was like, I want to partner with you on my own weekly comedy thing that's branded under your hotel. And I'll bring on sponsors. And they were 100% on board. So we're kicking it off in September.
That is awesome.
So we're going to get sponsors so I can, like, pay for people to come out, pay them, put them up, treat them well.
You know, if I haven't been to the Jimmy Kimmel Comedy Club yet. I hear it's nice.
Mm-hmm.
But if, for whatever it's worth, just for you, like, making the effort and doing that, not only is it going to be a great experience for you, you deserve that, like, having your own, like, show like that. You put in your time in that city. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And to have, like, to be taken care of. And hopefully, who knows how long it'll work or what.
I don't know.
But
I
at
mean,
least
we don't know.
You got to, you're in the game. You're in the game, and that's wonderful.
It just will make me feel great that once a month I'll get to fly out with another comedian pal that I really respect, and they'll be able to get taken care of. And
well, see, you're in the game. That's what I mean. And you're in the game, and that's wonderful. And it's a good feeling.
Yeah, I mean, I think you gotta figure out where your stake in the game can be, create your own. But yeah, I mean, it's super interesting because I feel like you're kind of entrepreneurial as well.
Well, yes.
And
yes.
So,
I'm in a weird position in that I've kind of, because LA being my hometown, so
yeah,
it's a little different. Like, I was always taught dominate your local market, then move on. You know, figure out how to do that. And my local market just happened to be LA. And I was very fortunate for a long time because I have a good local draw.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like, in the same note, I wish I didn't come up here because I was given opportunities when I wasn't quite ready. I'll be the first to admit.
Sure. I feel like a lot of people have.
Yeah, but like I was thrown in front of Netflix, HBO, all kind of William Moore. I just wasn't ready. And the thing is, like, when you're 3-4 years in and you have like 10, 15 good shows in a row, you're like, yeah, everything I say and do is going to crush.
In there.
And like, I'm selling out the improv. Like, these are the people who have been coming out for me and whoever. And I remember one night I was just dumb. Like, I had all brand new stuff. And like, some stages aren't meant for experimentation. Some stages, you got to go out with your A plus.
Fire.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's like, I'm like, everything I say is going to be funny. And I just remember the first 6 minutes of a 12, it was the worst. I saw in my mind's eye, I saw myself running off stage, just quitting comedy. And just being like, I'm out. And everyone being like, oh shit, that's how it ends.
Yep.
And you know, I picked myself up from that moment. And I cleared my head and I finished off fine, but I bombed. It was a bomb. Yeah. And I still, like, that's the fire. Like, I feel, I say on a daily basis, I think about that set.
How long ago was that?
It would have been, I'm 9 years Thanksgiving, so.
I'm 9 years too.
Five years.
Yeah. And that was an interesting time too, because
maybe 4 years now that I even think about it.
At that time in my career, I was regularly getting to perform at the Laugh Factory and the Comedy Store and the Improv, and then like everything switched over shortly thereafter, management and all that stuff.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
so
yeah.
Like, you know, everything kind of went through a switcheroo, and for a while I wasn't sure how I felt about stand-up either. And then I just kept booking myself in other cities, and I was like, I live in LA, but I don't want to perform here. It's very strange.
Well, Bobby Lee took me on the road one time
to
Fort Lauderdale, and he said never again because I'm too hyper. Like, and he's like, you can't have two hype people.
Yeah.
And he's like, I need someone low energy before me.
Yeah.
Because sometimes Bobby might only do 30 minutes.
Like, yeah.
He might, you know.
Just depending on what he feels.
Yeah, he might just be like, I don't even know if he likes comedy anymore. But Bobby's like, he's a wonderful human. Like, and he taught, like, he's taken me to Green Blast a few times and talked to me about my comedy. And he was like, just make sure you get in where you fit in.
Mm-hmm.
Because not everyone's going to give you love. And you don't need to get in everywhere. Get in where you fit in. And that's something that it took me a little while to realize in comedy. I would be like, why don't they like me? Why? What am I doing? Like, I'm here and I hang out and I don't bullshit anyone and I don't hurt anyone.
Same.
And I don't have sex with any comedians.
Same.
You know what I mean? Like,
And sometimes I used to feel like that would harm me. I was like, oh, is being in a long-term relationship fucking up my comedy career because nobody thinks I'm, like, viable or valuable to them whatever? But, you know, when it comes down to it, we all have our own path, and that's why I got so into the business side of comedy, because I was like, well, I'll just create my own way to do everything, and it's way more fun. I mean, it's a lot of work, but I'm about to go on tour to 5 cities that I know everybody in, and I'm going to see everybody that I haven't caught up with in a while.
Great.
And like, to me, that's really fun.
What cities?
So it's Mankato, Minnesota, Minneapolis, Stoughton, Madison, Milwaukee, Chicago.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm not advertising Milwaukee and Madison because those aren't big. Those are more, basically I'm headlining the whole thing and I set up door deals for each one.
Yeah.
So I'm pushing the ones that I need to sell tickets for.
Yeah. Totally. No, I know the game.
So on my social media, it doesn't look like I'm making a stop in Madison and Milwaukee, but I fucking am.
No, I totally.
Those ones are just ones I don't have to sell a certain amount of tickets for.
No, I totally get it. And, you know, a lot of people, you know, comedians that I know, like, sometimes, like, you get looked down, like, I get looked down on. I don't know about you, because people think I had to shake the promoter title for a long time. No, I'm a comedian with a following. I just know how to shake every hand and kiss every baby and follow up with people be a good person.
Uh-huh.
And I understand the business side of it, that since I'm not regularly on Comedy Central or whatever, I have to not only crush on stage, I got to shake every hand.
Yeah.
And I got to let these people know when I'm going to be performing, because my leverage is the fact that if you put me on stage, an extra 50 people will come.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And people don't realize that in LA. And I'm going to say this blatantly. There are almost no people that are draws in Los Angeles.
That's what 95% of comedians, no one will come see.
Nope. people don't promote their own shows. Like, I even have the one show that I have with Court, Boss Comedy.
Well, and you have free, and I said, like, if you guys ever need this, give me advance, and like, I send out to my email list, because I have a paid email list and a free email list, because once you're free, you never turn anyone back. Like, they'll never pay for a ticket ever again.
Yeah.
So you got to make them pay right away, and then they'll be like, oh, $5, $10, whatever. I get a discount code. That's how, and you have to keep on that.
Yeah.
You have to, and you got to use people who can get people there, because most of the time these comedians, they act like, oh, I'm just going to be famous and people are going to come. No.
No, people are like, yeah, I'll post about the show, and they'll put it on their story. And I'm like, do you not know that there was a comedian recently, I won't say who, but that hit me up because of Europe, because I have the connections in Europe, and me and Rachel had done our tour, and they were like, they wanted me to help with a show, and I offered, and I set them up for a show, and I set up a ticket link, and they have a big following on social media, and I was like, listen, just so you know, it's really hard to sell tickets in Europe.
Yeah.
As an American comedian, they don't know you, they don't really give a shit, they have to have a reason to want to go see you, and I said, put a Facebook event together, get interest, reach out to people individually, message them, you know, if you see any fans that message you that they want to come see you in a certain place, message them directly and say, and give them a code. You know, I gave this person all the pointers.
Yeah.
He didn't do any of it, and he had to cancel the show. And, you know, I put a lot of work into trying to help him, but I was like, oh, that just shows me I shouldn't help people. But you have to, like, put
well,
your ego in your
that
back
you shouldn't,
pocket.
Because I think that a lot, too. It's just that a lot of people, they think they're above the work.
They think
they're above the effort. Yep. They literally think that their comedy is enough. And I wish I lived in a world where that was the case.
Yeah, no, I'm sorry, but that's like never the case. Not anymore. It doesn't even matter acting or anything. Like,
no, man.
They're, God, who is it? So my fiance works with one of the biggest photographers in the world, and they just shot Jonathan Tucker the other day. Do you know who he is?
Sure.
Actor?
Yeah.
He even was talking to them about getting into a new business because he said making money in entertainment is so hard. And he's a big name, and he works all the time, but, like, maintaining a certain, you know, like the economy scale thing, like maintaining a certain amount of money or income is like hard for everybody. And so it's pretty, like, if you're not business savvy,
you'll die, flounder,
die, and then you become bitter, and then you hate what you do. I'm like, I would rather just figure out a way to make it work.
Yeah, and that's why, you know, I do live below my means. I do take into account, like, what can and can be done, and I take risk accordingly. Like, yeah, I blew all my credit one time filming a promo pilot to a sitcom that I wrote.
Yeah.
And, you know, I got totally scammed, you know, out of basically $20,000. Like, I mean, I got a product, but you could have done it for half the price, you know? Like,
you could have probably done it for way less than
half
the
price.
Well,
I mean, it was, you know, I rented a whole floor of an office building. Like, there's a lot of things I didn't need to spend money on. And some of the people I hired and whatnot. But I got a master's education in the things. And so, yeah, I'm all about taking calculated risks. But you got to be business savvy. And I see how some of the... I do pay attention to what other comedians doing, and that's why, like, I was real anti-podcast for the last year, anti-me doing a podcast.
Yeah.
But it's like, I see the way the market is, and I see how some of the big people, they've kind of gotten stale, and their numbers are starting to plateau, and it's like the experience that even you've gotten in just episodes interviewing people and putting yourself out there and the additional content you have and the additional format in which people can get to know you, it's so valuable and it's vital and it's extra work that you have to do, but you can't.
Well, and it's actually fun. Like, whenever people ask me, because I always have so many projects in the, you know, irons in the fire or whatever people say, but people are like, what's your favorite thing to do? And this is the answer I hear from a lot of people is I love having my podcast because I feel like I walk away from every episode legitimately becoming a much closer pal with whoever I had on. And I know more about them. I watch other people's podcasts where they're constantly trying to be like on or funny, and I get that, but I'm like, this is more like conversational. I want it to be about not me trying to look good, and you know, and I feel like I resonate with podcasts more like that, where you kind of like walk away learning something. You laughed, you cried. Yeah. I don't fucking know, but
my best friend out here, he's a big plastic surgeon. We're starting a doctor and a comedian.
Oh fuck yeah!
I just bought all like he's got his own surgery center. Everything, like, he's big time, you know. And
are you putting it together in your home?
We're gonna do it at his house. Nice. That's the only way I could get him to agree to do it.
As if he doesn't come to him.
As if he doesn't have to go anywhere.
Nice. Yeah. No, that's perfect. That's awesome.
So yeah. I had ordered all the equipment last week, and I'm still kind of getting my feet wet on everything else. You know.
So how long did you live in Florida growing up before you moved to California?
I don't really. A while. I was pretty young though. Parents got divorced 5, 6, 7, so 8 years or so, 9.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So not super long.
No, and then here, and then to Indiana, or Michigan, Indiana.
Did you go to high school in the Midwest?
Yeah, some.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you think hockey was going to be your thing?
No, I was just ambidextrous, so I could play both wings, and I was a little, like, a little fast guy.
Yep.
So, you know, like, I talked a lot of shit on the ice, and, you know, I got people out of their games.
You got good hockey hair.
Like, I would do little things. I'd fuck with people's sticks and stuff. Like, and then, you know, I just lost. I don't know. My shoulder blew out. Like, I can't lift my right arm up anymore. I went to Indiana for it. But, yeah, like, I mean, I've had multiple surgeries. But, I played my freshman year. And then after that, like, they had fitted me up with all kind of braces. And then I went through one surgery and a second surgery. And after that, I was just done. Yeah. But I learned my gift of gab, I think. Well, no, I mean, I think I honed it because I had an athletic scholarship in Indiana. Instead of, like, cutting me, they were like, you can be an ambassador to all these incoming athletes. You just have to take, like, their family and the kid on tour. And it's like, if the kid needs a mentor or something, they have to be able to call you in the middle, and you know, whatever.
Yeah.
I'm like, sure, whatever. You know, so it'd usually be offensive linemen, swimmers, people like that. And this one swimmer, I'll never forget. This guy was an Olympic caliber swimmer. And the coach didn't want him to join. And I was supposed to be this guy's mentor. And the coach didn't want him to join a fraternity. Mm-hmm. And he calls me in the middle of the night. He's like, bro, I just don't want to swim anymore. I'm just burnt out. I just want to join the fraternity. And it's literally the middle of the night. And I'm just tired. I'm like, dude, just do whatever you want, man. And he quits swimming and joins the fraternity. And then he drops out of school 6 months later, a year later, whatever.
Shit.
And I'm always like, what if I'd have been like, no, dude, stick with swimming. You could go to the Olympics. I wonder if he would have gone to the, like, I wonder if that was the straw.
Hey, that's not on you. That's fucking him. That's
I
him.
I still think to this day, though. What if I was the straw that broke the back, right?
You have nightmares. What was this guy's name?
Nick Arzner.
Arzner?
He became a meth head. Like, we had heard, like, he was beating his wife, like, three, four years later.
He had his own choose-your-own-adventure story, and he fucking chose all
the wrong
adventure.
Yeah, and kept going. He's like, do you drink and beat your wife, or do you go swim? I beat my wife.
Yeah. Same motion. Different.
He lost his mind. He was like, that was your guy. That was your guy. Because people like knew him from the home. Because he was like a famous high school swimmer. You know?
Oh, it's crazy.
He had a great swimming name, you know.
So did you, like, if you thought you, did you think you were going to go pro, or did you?
In my mind, just because I'm a little guy, I'm naturally a little guy. Like, I know some of the guys that I were playing against that were pro. They were just, their frames were different than mine. Like, I was fast, and I could move real well.
Yeah.
But their frames were just different. They were just bigger. And I never in my mind. Yeah, and hockey was, like, I happened to grow up next to a hockey coach, and his kids sucked at hockey, and I was all right, and I went out with him. And that's why, it was never really in, you know, my family or anything. It was
all my guy friends played hockey growing up.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So I just grew up next to people who, you know, who were in it.
Yeah, we had like a state champion team. It was the only team in my high school that was really good. We had wrestling and hockey. Our football team sucked. Our cheerleaders sucked. Sorry, guys. But yeah, I mean, it was just like, it wasn't anything that impressive.
You literally just lost six listeners. Right,
six whole listeners. Well, I'm about to go and perform in my hometown for the first time ever.
And the name of the town is?
Stoughton, Wisconsin.
Stoughton.
Mm-hmm. And
how do people from Stoughton say it?
Stoughton.
Stoughton?
Stoughton.
Okay, I just didn't know if it was like Stoughton or Stoughton.
But I shot my comedy special in June in Madison, and that one sold out, and I was like, oh, I should probably just do a Stoughton show so Stoughton people can
yeah,
come.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And, yeah, I mean, it's probably going to be the best show that I have on my door.
Yeah, but that's not fair. That's like shooting fish in a barrel. You're just going to be like, hello, everyone. Ah!
I know. Literally, I can do like 90 minutes,
yeah,
and they're
gonna
will
act
love...
like you're Eddie Murphy.
I know.
4 minutes into it, like
it's gonna be. I'm gonna crush it so hard. I am Eddie Murphy. What are you talking about?
I am Eddie Murphy.
So when did you know that you thought you might want to be a performer?
Oh man, comedy. I guess it really didn't hit me till right out of college. I went to Stella Adler.
Yeah,
right at the acting school. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I thought acting. One of my degrees was in theater. I went to school for 5 years. Like, I had a great time. Like, I was in no.
You were the.
But I had a Florida scholarship. My mom's like, you're not going to leave school with a theater degree. Like, if you do, like, I will light you on fire. So I stayed. I got a business degree too. But I came out.
But that works. That's
oh, yeah.
Smart.
It was very important. You know,
yeah,
it was
no,
in marketing.
It's really smart.
Yeah, it was.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it was very important. I learned quite a bit,
yep.
And I'm very thankful for that part of the education, my mother's push. Go to Stella Adler, working like regular office jobs. I worked for the science magazine. I'm called The Scientist. They sent me all over the world, and they worked with my schedule. I could work from home, so I could still go to the full-time acting program. Yeah, it was good, but it was no pay. The money, I think it was like $28,000 a year, but they sent me all over the world.
You had to travel for free.
Yeah, for free. And I basically just had to be the face of this science magazine. It was a life science magazine. I just had to get people sign. They would send
me
like...
Was it like Oprah, where you were just on the cover of every magazine?
No, I wasn't on the cover. No. I just had to talk about it because the people who wrote the magazines, like, they weren't personable at all. So, like, we just need someone to go to these trade shows and sign doctors up for free subscriptions, and once you're done signing, once all the magazines are given away, you can do whatever you want, and you come home.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, great. They sent. I mean, I went everywhere. Rio, Europe, Switzerland, yeah, everywhere. Like, I went everywhere. Hong Kong, I went tons of places. But I ran into someone from the Wall Street Journal, and they're like, what do you do here? I'm like, I don't know. They call me a marketing specialist. And 3 weeks later, they offered me a job, a public relations job, the Wall Street Journal. Yeah, right up here, right up the street, the West Coast office. So I took the job. It was a great job, I thought.
It kind of brought you into that journalism business world.
I guess, yeah.
Marketing.
Yeah, and, you know, I wasn't really, you know, the acting, I was getting auditions when I was at Stella Adler through one of the teachers who had hooked me up with her agent. You know, I was getting some auditions. I had done a pilot that never went through. It was a Nickelodeon one. And then another one for an untitled. They sent me out to New York for Viacom.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was good. Like, I'd booked a couple things.
Yeah.
But nothing, like, panned out. Wall Street Journal offers me the job, but it's a full-time job. You know, and
yeah,
everyone in my family, you know, there was a tons of pressure for me to have some more stability.
Yeah.
And the job was like 82, from 25 to 82. Okay, but this is the crazy thing. Within 2 months, one person quits, and then the person who hired me got pregnant and was going on maternity leave. So they basically promoted me. I was the West Coast Public Relations Manager within 3 weeks of working in the Wall Street Journal. I'm making over $100,000 a year. I had my license had just gotten suspended because I bought myself this crazy Mercedes, and I got caught doing 115 on the 110. I was racing a Corvette.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. My license gets suspended.
How old were you at this point?
24.
God, making that much money at 24. I'm so glad I was piss broke at 24. Otherwise, I would have been full of STDs.
Because I didn't start comedy until 27, 28. Like, I didn't even start comedy.
Yeah,
like, I started
been
late.
Fucked.
Yeah. So, what was I going to say? Yeah, my license gets suspended. Can't drive my car. I'm literally walking to work because I live right behind the Ivy,
mm-hmm.
right up the street on Robertson, walking to work. And I hate my life. I'm like, I hate my job. I hate this. I hate this. I hate this. Like, I'm literally driving myself into the ground. I was drinking too much. I was
mm-hmm.
doing drugs. I was unhappy with my job. I'd be on conference calls at 6 a.m., you know, and I hadn't really slept the night before, like, with New York, because I just hate it. Like, I just needed to be on the phone. They didn't need my input for anything. Yeah. I had literally nothing to offer. I was totally underqualified. I still, when I think back, I was like, I don't even know what they expected me to do.
You were like George Costanza. Yeah. You just shut up
just
and
I'm going in the office and I'm surfing and I'm shopping all day. You know, and I'm in this fucking cubicle that looks at the wall like this. Like, you know, like I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing. And I'm like just doing things and I'll be offering up input at meetings and I'm like, okay, yeah, sure, kid. Just go put that in the corner. Right? Like,
oh my God.
And I'm just like, you know, like, and nobody wanted to talk to me. Nobody, everyone was concerned about themselves.
Friends, yeah.
And the Wall Street Journal, a few years previously had been bought by News Corp. That's basically Fox News.
Yep, yep.
So it was going through a transition. And I walk into the office one day and my computer's gone. And there's this little notepad, like this little, like, post-it notepad thing that says, come see me. And I was basically the only public relations guy in an office full of salesmen, like ad salesmen. And the ad manager, he hated me because my salary came out of his budget and I didn't do anything for his people. And he drove from Pasadena every day and had a pool that he never got to use and three kids he didn't like. You know, he just didn't like me I didn't wear a tie. And
oh my God.
You know, and he's like, you gotta wear a tie. I'm like, no, I don't. Like, it doesn't say anywhere I have to wear a tie. I know I don't.
Yeah.
No, I don't.
No, I don't.
And so it's like, we would get into it all the time. He loves this. He's like, okay, they're shutting down the public relations division, News Corp. Shutting down your position. You can take a sales job in New York or like the worst severance package. And like, I didn't remember the smile on his face. Oh, he was so happy. It's like, you take this shitty, like you get 6 months of health insurance and a quarter or half your salary, whatever. And, or a job in New York, a sales job in New York, which I didn't want. I'd like an advertising sales job in New York. And I'm like, I'll take the severance. And that's when I started. Well, I was in a real low place. I started dating this Saudi princess who was extremely toxic. We lived in the south of Spain in Marbella for a while.
Whoa.
Yeah, she attacked me with a knife. She was manic depressive.
Wait,
like,
okay, so we have to go into that a little bit more. How did you end up meeting this girl? And how did
I'm from LA. You know, you just meet people out. I didn't have a job. I'm just out of parties. And, you know, you're partying with people. And I meet someone. I think I fall in love because I'm Captain Save-A-Ho. And it was just super toxic.
I've accidentally fallen in love with people.
Well, I'm Presidente Save-A-Ho. I'm being kind.
Save-A-Bro over here.
Yeah, so you get it, yeah. And it's such a bad relationship. And I think I can fix everything, you know? Like, this girl, like, would eat pills like Tic Tacs. And I kind of got her to calm down and sober. Like, but this was the kind of person who had an allowance of $15,000 a month.
What?
And was broke by the 10th. Like, had no money. Not even by the 15th. Couldn't even make it to halfway through the month.
$15,000?
And that's after your bills are paid. That's just your spending money. Trust me. Like, and this person was like a hoarder. They had piles of stuff all on there.
Oh, people just don't. Like
in a three-story
place. Economy is such a scale. People don't know what they've got until they don't have it. Like,
I mean, long story short, we moved to Marbella. It was terrible. I was getting the shit beat out of me on a regular basis, and I was just taking it. And I do this joke on stage. I took it like I was the wife of an NFL running back.
Yeah.
Like, my wife ain't getting suspended. No way. No, my girlfriend, no.
Oh,
so,
shit.
So, literally, when I had no money left, all my cards were maxed out because I'm doing, like, this girl's dad lived in Spain. She was Muslim.
Mm-hmm.
And south of Spain is very Muslim area.
Yeah.
So we're living in Marbella. Her dad is like, look, you have to marry my daughter. You calm her down. You need to stay with her. I'm going to have to go to Saudi for like 9 months. You're going to have to stay with her. And I'm like, what? He's like, no, you got to marry her. So I know you're not going to go anywhere. I'm like, what? Like, this guy rolled around with armed guards. Like, this guy was, he stole $100 million from the upstate of New York. Like, this guy was no fucking joke. He wasn't allowed in the United States.
So you're like, I can't fuck.
So I'm like, what? So I'm like, yeah, yeah. In the middle of the night, I had 100 euros left. I call a cab when she's sleeping. Cost me 56 euros to get to the airport. No ticket. I get on an internet kiosk with, these are dime euros now that I got. Put it in, go to Verizon.com, put my mom's number in there. And I'm like, Mom, you're right. I fucked up. I should never be here. Please help me. I'm at this airport. I have no ticket. I will come home. I'm just texting. It's the middle of the night there. She gets these texts. Her, my stepdad at the time, like a few hours later, her Brian Moreno, check into Lufthansa Air. And I was literally on the plane and I was crying, totally devastated. Like, my life, I had no money. I had no job. I didn't know what I was going to do. And
what age? You were like 27. At this,
I was 26. Yeah. 26. Yeah, about to be 27. Yeah, and I watched George Carlin, and something about it just stuck in my mind. And I remember coming back to L.A., and everyone was afraid I was going to get back with her, and Angelo Bowers had just died.
Yeah.
That's when I started coming.
I just had Josh Adam Myers on.
That month.
That was such a, it still is a detrimental piece of his life.
And he died, and I remember, and the George Carlin thing was still in my mind, because I knew I could do my work. I knew words were my gift. I could put them in groups, and I could make people feel with my words.
Yeah.
I just didn't know how to express it. Like, that was my art. And
you didn't know, like, we don't know that's a job yet.
Well,
like
no one had ever has shown me I could do that. I was always boxed in. Like, I had to play sports. I had to go to college. I had to, you know, like, I just, because I was good at it, not because I ever wanted to do anything.
Yeah.
So I always felt like I was just doing what I was supposed to do. I was supposed to do. And then finally, like, I had nothing. So I just had to figure out on my own. And I was low and I was down, and Angelo Bowers had died. It was tragic. And I was reading about it and the camaraderie in the comedy world. I remember I went to Marty's that night to try. I got on stage, and Dana Moon and Michael Lenoce were in the back. And I thought I was going to be Mitch Hedberg. And I had 25 one-liners written.
That was my first.
Right?
I had one-liners.
And I remember them looking at me and laughing at me. You know, Marty's was this horrible, shitty open mic. And this is my first time. And they're laughing at me. And I'm so embarrassed. And I'm like, okay, if I'm going to do this, I can't do it in L.A. I got to go somewhere where I don't know anyone, where there's no pressure. So I stayed. I flew out to my stepdad's place in Jersey, and I took buses between Philadelphia and New York for like 2 years to do open mics.
Shit.
I came back about a year, and a little over a year. And then I came back, and I get the job as the MC of the House of Blues.
And when it was still across the
Comedy
Store.
Yeah, I get my SAG card, that was right away. Like, when I came back, and I'm like, I'm going to do it. I'm going to dedicate. I reached out to all my connections. I did everything. I got some lines on the show called Masters of Sex on Showtime. Got my SAG card. And then the House of Blues brought me in. I had no hook. They were like, look, because I was the MC. Like, they basically, the MC, his car broke down. And the guy who was the booker, he calls me up. Because I was a backer. I was doing extra work on the set. And this guy was a PA. He's also the booker of the House of Blues and stuff. And he's like, yo, you're a comedian? Calls me up. He's like, we got to tell those 1,500 people that the band they paid for isn't showing up. They're not going to get a refund, but here's $50 and free drinks tonight if you want the job. And I'm like, yeah, sure. I go out there. This one guy from the upper deck threw a beer at me because I didn't know what I was doing. He thought I was a real comedian. He didn't know I'd only been doing open mics for a couple years. Like, he thought, you know? So I'm like, and I'm like, I don't want to. This was the moment. I'm like, I don't want to be here either. And they just all start laughing. You know, and I was like, but the band is really good. And then I start doing some stuff. And I'm like, that's what? You just be real.
Yeah.
And I learn. And then the House of Blues, they gave me this room. And they're like, you have 2 hours every Friday. It's all you. Brian Moreno comedy. I had literally 90 seconds of jokes. I'm like, what do you mean I got 2 hours?
But that's where you started your following.
Yeah, and that's how. And then I shook every hand. And like towards the end, there was no air conditioning. And people would still line up to sunset to get in.
So we
would turn the audience over because people would literally be dying. They'd lost 6 pounds in sweat. Be like, okay, let's put a new audience member there.
Fuck.
Yeah, and then we would just go and go and go. And then Russell Peters did it one time. And he was like, man, I see what you're doing. He's like, don't ever stop hosting because a great host makes a great headliner. It's like, when you figure out how to host, then you can start doing regular sets.
Yeah.
And I swear to God, I only started doing regular sets about 2 years ago.
It's humbling. Like, because that was the first thing. I started in Chicago at Second City. And when I decided I wanted to do stand-up, I found a stage and started hosting a weekly open mic. And I didn't know any stand-up comedians in Chicago. So I had one of my friends, Anthony Bonazzo, who was the only improv, because I had only done improv for 5 years.
Yeah.
He introduced me to everybody in Chicago, and I would just book people based on him. It was a booked mic.
Yeah.
And that's how I learned how to even put together any sort of time. I think people shit on hosting, but it makes you so good.
Oh, it does. I remember one time, Jamar Neighbors and Gerard Carmichael were doing the House of Blues, and they were in the back, and they were like, I was hosting, opened up, and people were still just getting sad. It was like early, still light out, and they're in the back, and I'm trying to do jokes and act outs. Like, I don't know what I'm doing. Like, I'm just trying to figure out. And they are laughing at me like this dude is the worst comic I've ever seen in my life. And I still remember thinking that in my mind. I was like, I may have been that horrible, but I had no hook, which was wonderful. You need that time to experiment and to try. And yeah, I didn't want to make a fool in front of comedians, but no one's going to be like, okay, no more. We got to put Brian in corner for a while.
Right.
It didn't matter. I was allowed to do anything I wanted as long as the people kept coming. And the House of Blues allowed me to keep all the email addresses. So that's why my email list is so big. And it all happens for a reason. And then when they closed it in, the improv brought me in. And you know, like I said, that's when my head got a little big. Mm-hmm. I was like, I'm it. I'm on path to stardom.
Yeah.
And then I just drove myself into the ground a little. But no, not, you know, I was really hard on myself for a while because I bombed. Like I started questioning my comedy and my own.
I understand that trajectory because I feel like that's a big, that I've said this to a lot of other people. When you're good at all in the first 1 or 2 years, you think you're just going to make it really fast. And then, like, by year 4 and 5, you're, like, questioning everything. I think that was the time where I, for the first time in my career, that I was, like, maybe I just don't really like stand-up that much. I was just kind of over it for a second. I was still performing, like, 4 nights a week. But for me, being over it was, that was the max that I would do.
See, my father died 2 years ago. Last year, when I was going through a little bit, like, I broke my foot and cracked my tooth, like, at the same time, so I couldn't work out. Like, brittle bones, Brian.
Not from the same thing, right?
No, not from the same thing. And I was like, you know, and I, like, a lot of the stuff, because my dad was a very big hater of my comedy, and I was just mentally in a very tough
place.
How
did he pass?
Lung cancer.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, he would say, No. He would say, chemotherapy doesn't make me throw up, but your jokes do. Like, he was, yeah, tough guy. Now, I mean, that's hilarious under most circumstances, but it's also a therapy session down the line.
Yeah, no, that's a hard thing to let that settle with you after losing somebody, too.
Well, it took me probably a year, like a year after I came to terms with it a little more. And that's why I go to Ohio. I sold his house, and I'm going to pack up some of the stuff that's meaningful to me, and I'm going to drive it across country next week.
Oh, like now?
Yeah. It took me a couple years to sell the house because I just didn't want to.
Yeah.
You know, it's like a part of me knows that one day I could have made him proud, but he just was never able to live long enough to see that.
Well, and I think it's tough when we lose people because we, you know, we automatically think of what we could have had with them or what we should have done or all this stuff. But the fact of the matter is, we can't do anything about it.
No,
it sucks to have to say that.
No, we can't. And this is why I tell people, say what's on your mind. Say what you feel and allow the ones that you love to know that you love them.
Mm-hmm.
Even like there was a moment, I still remember the last time I saw my dad. I wish there was just one thing I would have said to him. Like, you know, like, it's okay. Like, because he was sad that he's like, he didn't do better for me because he was mean. He was really hard on me. Like,
yeah,
in a really, really hurtful way. And at the end, I know I wish I could have told him it was okay. Like, because I still remember him and I think about him all the time, you know?
Of course.
But he taught me to be resilient and to get up and, you know, don't listen to the fuzz.
Yeah. I think that's a big thing that a lot of my family is in entertainment musically. I have a big music family.
See, he was very business.
And they dealt with a lot of that kind of stuff from their parents. And I feel like that's the biggest thing with people. I haven't lost any of my parents yet, but I've lost a lot of other people that I love. And, you know, I feel like people always want to have this resolution when they lose somebody to feel like the person was proud of them.
That ain't always going to be the
and
way
you're not
it
gonna
is.
Not going to get that.
No.
You know, a lot of people aren't going to get that. And so, and that's okay because
it's just how it is.
It's just how it is.
Yeah,
and it sucks to have to say
that. So that's why,
yeah,
say the things that are on your mind when they are. Because, you know, and I did, some of the times when I told my dad how horrible he was, like, I still feel good about it, though. Because at least I told him. right?
Yeah.
I don't want him slug going into deathbed thinking he did all right.
He was okay. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, how much shittier would that be if you get up to the pearly gates and you're like, yeah, I was awesome. And they're like, well, I just want you to know how many times you actually sucked. I don't want you to completely misconstrue where you're at. You should be a little grateful.
And just so to be clear, when I came back after the Wall Street Journal, my next real job after that was being a DJ at a strip club. Like, that's how I lived in my
car.
Josh
Adam Myers did that.
He got me.
He got you the job?
Because I came back and he took me to open mics and stuff because he was like, he was the one who was saying, like, you got to leave LA. You know too many people. He would drop me off. He was on one, like, at the time. And he still barely even remembers doing some of the stuff he did, but it was very meaningful to me.
Yeah.
And he would take me around. And then when I came back to LA and before I got the House of Blues job, and even when I had that job, like, I still needed more money. And he's like, I can get you. And I went to his strip club for an audition. And he's like, you've done this before, right? And I'm like, yeah, sure. Of course I have. Like, no. I've never done. I get on there and I'm doing my thing. And he's like, no, dude, stop. So he gets another. He's like, whatever you were doing there, don't do that again.
Oh, no.
He gets me another audition at another strip club deep in the valley, like a day shift strip club in the valley. Like, girls had, like, one arm. Like, it was bad.
Oh,
It was bad. So that's where I learned for a few shifts. And then I came up the street and was working at the Star Strip on La Siena. He got me all these jobs.
Oh, my God.
Him and Eric Allegria.
Yeah. Eric Allegria, what? Oh, my God. Yeah, I haven't had him on yet, but that is so funny.
They got me my first. And then Josh would come in. He would come in and show up to see how I'm doing. Because he's like, I'd never heard anything so bad on the mic before. Because I was like, yeah, of course I know what I'm doing. And
oh
I got
God.
There, and I just remember the first time, because I thought you had to be like, but like later on, I was more like, get your dollars out, ladies. Get your dollars out for the ladies. The better the tipping, the better the strip. You know, I was more like, I had a smooth sensual. You know, at first, it was like during my audition, I was like, now come to sleep.
You were just trying to be like that heckly comedian that you envisioned.
I had no idea. And Josh is immediately like, stop.
He's like,
stop.
That's not sexy. Nobody's going to want to fuck anybody or spend money with that voice.
I wish I had that audition tape.
Oh, my God.
There are certain audition tapes I wish I had. Like, there was one time they sent me to a Spanish-speaking audition. I speak Spanish, but I got to know ahead of time. And, like, I had to do, like, a pirate that morphed into a football player. I was like, arg, a key. And, like, if I wish I had that, like, if that
do
made
pirates in Spanish pirates, do they still say arg, or is it different?
Well, that was the line. I was like, is that how they would say it? Arg, a key?
Yeah. I'm like, I feel like they would have a different affectation for that. Like.
Well, if that ever made YouTube, I would feel happy. There'd be a warmth in my heart.
Oh, my God. There's so many things that I'm like, pop up on YouTube.
Yeah, in the moment, you're embarrassed by it, but later on, you're like, I'd like to see that one more time.
I know. I used to do a lot of man on the street videos when I was in high school with a real video camera, like a giant one.
Oh, if you could get a hold of some of those.
Yeah, and we used to fuck with people on State Street in Madison all the time, and it wasn't easy to hide, but...
Well, yeah, because
it was
like
giant.
A bazooka, right?
Yeah, it was a firearm. And you had to put the whole tape in. And but yeah, I mean, there's people I've hit up over the course of the last couple of years where I've been like, if you ever find these tapes, like, please send them to me.
Yeah.
I want to see
God,
this.
That would be gold.
I want the archives.
That's comedy gold right
now.
Oh,
my God, right? Well, what would you say in closing that you're most excited about coming up? Or what are you?
Well, I'm most excited that I had got Natasha and I
scratch off.
So if she wins, 50% goes to me. So I'm most excited about
Is this how it goes? Are we 50-50?
I'm most excited about the $37,250 I will probably be getting.
That was really good fast math.
Well, you know.
A lot of people can't do that. Carry the... Yes, where can everybody find you?
Let's see. I'm gone for 2 weeks. I go to Ohio. I'm just doing some guest spots at the Funny Bone in Dayton.
If you want to pop up to Chicago at all, you can guest spot on some of my
stuff. When are the dates?
I'll be in Chicago on and off for the last 2 weeks of my tour.
Okay.
But I'll
message it. Is
it
on your website or
anything?
Yeah, I'll
message you all
of it. Check
it
out.
Let me know.
Yeah, I so I'll do a couple guest spots at the Dayton Funny Bone. They're super nice to me there.
Yep.
And that's like an hour from the house, so it's not too bad of a drive. Yeah, and then I drive cross country, and I'll be back at the Improv September. You guys, Brian Moreno Comedy, or go to the website, go to my Instagram. If you ever want free tickets, I'll always make sure to hook you up because that's the least I can do for her audience, and thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, no, I thank
this
you
was,
for having me.
This was not only very therapeutic, it was a very good...
I try to keep it a balance like that. I mean, because it's therapeutic for me, too, to have good conversations with good people and just understand where everybody's coming from. You know, we all have different reasons why we're in this business, why we look up to certain people, and I find it fascinating, and I don't think everything should be about being on all the time. I think it should be about getting to the grit of, like, why the fuck you do this kind of stuff. So, cool. I appreciate you being on. And you can find me at MPH Comedy on Twitter and Instagram.
Awesome.
Or mphcomedy.com/TIX for all my tour tickets. You can follow the podcast at Future Role Model or at Role Model Pod. Any closing remarks?
This was a great time. Thank all of you.
Thank you. All right. Bye.
Yeah, cool. Make sure to-